Christian. If you're here, please fly away. Paul Gotti Esquire, 1995 to 1996. Joanne Paroulis, 1996. Jim Clark, 1996 to 1997. Ray Stoudemire, 1998 to 1999. Robert S. Carl Jr., 2001 to 2002. Bill Kerwin, 2005 to 2006. Ken Huebner, wherever you're hiding, 2009 to 2010. Mark Finelli, 2013 to 2014. Our distinguished guests. In our opinion, all of you here today are distinguished guests, and we thank you all for joining us. But we would like to recognize that we have two tables of elected officials and their representatives with us today. If the representatives and elected officials all are towards the back of the room, would please stand to be acknowledged. And now I have the pleasure of introducing the executive committee that I have worked with very hard over the last 9 to 10 years as we've gone along, and it has truly been a pleasure. First Vice President Tony Everdale, St. Clair and Associates. Second Vice President Jeanine Porter, Boyer's Food Market. Treasurer Jeff O'Neill, M&T Bank. Our secretary, Ed Keyworth III, chose to be in a canoe instead of here with us. And Ed is from Hospital Provision Company. Our past president, Mark Finelli, American Computer Associates. And our two executive committee members, Greg Stewart, Alfred Benson Company, who's in the canoe with Ed. And then Tina Fey, D.G. Yingling and Son. Tina? We would also like to recognize the retiring board members and the retiring past president. Mark Finelli, this is his last year on our executive committee as he rolls off as the immediate past president. Mark, thank you so much for your service. It's been a true pleasure. The retiring board members that are present today, when I call your name, if you would please come up to receive your farewell clock. Kelly Malone. Judith Schweig. Other retiring board members who are not able to be here today are Kim Knoll, Christine Satora, Alicia Fleischut, and Shelby Hofstetter. Administration Director. She's in the back. coordination director. She's also in the back. And I would also like to acknowledge our YAY program manager, Carol Boyer, who thought she could slide into retirement, but instead she now is with the Schuylkill Chamber. Carol? Okay, now comes my year in review. If I could sum this last year up in one word, it would be awesome. When I started the year, I announced that my goal was to take down a mountain. And thanks to the incredible chamber staff, an executive committee, the board of directors, and all of the chamber members, we did it. We have taken this chamber north, south, east, and west. We've been to Shenandoah, Ashland, McAdoo, Tamaqua, Friedensburg, Schuylkill Haven, Orangeburg, Pottsville, and everywhere in between. And every event was a huge success. We also have 8 affiliate organizations with the Chamber from all corners of the county. They are all meeting now on a quarterly basis. They are sharing best practices, information, but most of all, they are building relationships. I'm proud of what we have accomplished, and I thank you all for your support, because without you, it would not have happened. Thank you. Another big highlight was being a part of the initial year of the Young Entrepreneur Academy, also known as YAY. For those of you that are not familiar with YAY, it is a program where students, grades 6 through 12, come together and actually take a 30-week course learning how to come up with a big idea for a business, how to pitch that business to a group of investors that actually literally provide them seed money to launch a business. We had 13 students enter this program this year and 7 businesses that launched. Last night was their graduation. The winning company from our program was called Payer. It is owned by Alexandra Albertini and, I don't want to mess up this name, Jan Hepp. They will be representing Schuylkill County in the actually regional YAY competition to be held in Rochester, New York. Wish them all great success as they move forward representing us. What I took away most from YAY, though, was actually the students. Every event I attended, you could not help but feel the energy, the excitement, the inspiration. Those 13 kids gave much more back to all of us than we could ever hope to give to them. So support them as they begin year 2. Now, I would not be able to finalize my year in review without properly thanking the chamber staff. And to do this, I would like Tony to join me. Until you're inside the chamber, you can't imagine the work that is done by the 4 employees. No job is too big, no task is too much trouble. They truly are the wind beneath our wings. The teamwork is a pleasure to watch. They are one united force with one mission and one goal, the success of the Chamber in Schuylkill County. Each of them is a leader, an entrepreneur, and their commitment and dedication to moving Schuylkill County forward is second to none. Tony and I wanted to recognize and thank them in a very public, special way. So Bob, Vanessa, Andrea, and Monica, would you please come forward? Each of you with the Schuylkill Chamber 2015 Board President Superstar Award. You are each superstars, and we thank you for all you do for the community. Thank you. Okay. To sum it all up, I had an awesome year. I thank you for all your support and have a wonderful afternoon. I would now like to introduce Jeffrey Amiel, who is going to announce the Chamber's annual award winner.
Businessman of the Year. The Schuylkill Chamber 2015 Businessman of the Year is no stranger to hard work and innovation. This forward-thinking philosophy and innovation keeps the various companies vibrant, strengthening our local economy and improving the quality of life for his employees. This gentleman has demonstrated excellence in his profession for years. In 2014 alone, he was responsible for building a state-of-the-art raw coal sizing plant, a coal bagging plant, created a North American premium anthracite, and he is capable of working two businesses to fill locations here in Schuylkill County. He is involved in multiple charities throughout Schuylkill County and beyond, including Boy Scouts of America, MBA, Elements at Hershey. His various companies are responsible for the development of the Indian Commerce Center and bringing new business to Schuylkill County. Through his vision, contributions, and demonstration of excellence, this man epitomizes business and community leadership. He's a businessman whose accomplishments and successes have been omnipresent in Schuylkill County for many years. Our 2015 Businessman of the Year is Brian Rich. Okay, moving right along. Next we'll bring our For-Profit Organization of the Year. Schuylkill Chamber 2015 For-Profit Organization of the Year has been serving its clients since 1946. This employee-owned firm is united in their commitment to quality and engineering excellence and actively supports education by providing job shadowing opportunities, internships, scholarships, and annual math talents competitions. Over 550 skilled professionals and support personnel strong throughout the United States, this organization specializes in providing civil and structural engineering services, transportation, and infrastructure development, and is consistently ranked among the top 500 consulting engineering firms in the United States by Engineering News Record. The employees conduct annual toy and food drives with all proceeds donated to Schuylkill County nonprofits. They participate in the Scooping Out of Way Day of Caring, and members of the staff are active in various community organizations. Serving a broad range of markets, client-focused and dedicated in their community to quality and engineer excellence, the 2015 For-Profit Organization of the Year is Alfred Benish & Company. Next will be our nonprofit organization year. The Schuylkill Chamber 2015 Nonprofit Organization Year is one of Schuylkill County's oldest businesses. Has provided exceptional service to the residents of Schuylkill County since 1834, continually improving each year. Over the years, a total of $121 million has been invested into infrastructure, promoting economic development, and the creation of over 6,000 jobs. Since 1996, they have acquired 8 family or non-compliant water and sewer systems and brought them into compliance. They are a primary sponsor for the annual Schuylkill County EnviroFund and a contributor to the Schuylkill County Youth Summit and the Schuylkill Yay program. Annually, they award 10 environmental stewardship scholarships to county high schools. Their employees serve on numerous boards throughout both Schuylkill County and the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Through strategic planning, fiscal responsibility, and effective partnering, the organization has proven to be a model nonprofit. They are a successful partner to local government and private industry and are the source of safe drinking water and reliable sewer service to both the residents and businesses of Schuylkill County. The 2015 Nonprofit Organization Year is the Schuylkill County Municipal Authority. Chamber 2015 Entrepreneur of the Year has been innovating to stay ahead of the curve and the competition for years. The continual product improvements and new product development within this company have been the lifeblood of this organization. It currently holds 9 patents and has another 14 patents pending. Quoted in the Wall Street Journal and multiple trade publications, as an authority in his industry, his business saw an impressive 43% growth and sales in 2014. He is a team leader and a proponent of a team atmosphere that facilitates team bonding and communication between the employees and management. His focus is always on the big picture, taking six or seven steps ahead. His desire to ensure an adequate succession plan is the focus of company training and development within every department of his company. He provides local nonprofits with reduced product costs through their facilities, is actively involved with the American Heart Association, American Cancer Society, and local food banks. A true entrepreneur, he lives with complete dedication to his company, its employees, and its environment. The 2015 Entrepreneur of the Year is Greg Heder, CEO of Solar Innovation. Congratulations to all the winners. Let's please give all of them a round of applause. We will honor our recipients and present their awards at our June 10th breakfast. I would encourage all of you to try and make the event to recognize these special award winners. I know you're all anxious to hear from two very special ladies remaining on the agenda. One is our incoming president, Tony Everill, and the other is our keynote speaker, Megan Brennan. Each of these business individuals has reached the pinnacle of their professions, and both were born and raised in Schuylkill County. So I will end with an inspirational quote from Mark Twain. 20 years from now, you will be more disappointed by the things that you didn't do than the ones you did do. So throw off the bow lines, sail away from safe harbor, and catch the trade winds in your sails. Explore, dream, discover. Dare to make a difference, dare to get out of your comfort zone, dare to get involved, dare to be great, believe in you. Thank you again, congratulations to all the winners. You need tech support.
Now, it is my honor and privilege to have the opportunity to introduce Tony Everdale, our incoming president. Tony is a graduate of Bloomsburg University and has more than 25 years' experience in small business accounting and tax preparation. As a CPA and senior accountant with the firm of St. Clair & Associates, Tony is responsible for supervising and instructing staff members on work performed in-house. She consults with clients on general business matters and takes a hands-on approach with clients to assist them with installing, designing, and supporting their accounting software. She's a QuickBooks Pro advisor and also works with Peachtree. Tony has recently passed her Series 7 exam with the Securities and Exchange Commission and has become licensed as a financial advisor with Oppenheimer & Company, Inc. Tony serves as the Vice President of the Schuylkill Chamber of Commerce, the President of the Schuylkill Chamber Foundation Board, the Treasurer of Grace United Methodist Church of Worth Carbon, and is past treasurer of the former United Cerebral Palsy, now known as Avenue. Tony?
Thank you, Karen. Good afternoon, everyone, and I would like to thank you all for joining us today. I look forward to leading the chamber in the upcoming year, but it truly is a team effort. So in that regard, I would like to introduce the following members who will be joining the board for the first time. If you're here, if you could please stand when I call your name and hold your applause till the end. The new members, first new member, Jamie Barton, Jack Ritchie, Cynthia Minch, Alberni University Schuylkill Center, Trey Arnold, Wiener Iron and Metal Corp. Champ Holman from the Holman Corp. Frank Kohler, SAPA. Kevin Steele from HB Steele & Son. And Jennifer Tahaney from the Seltzer Group. I would also like to recognize our board members who will be continuing as directors for the upcoming fiscal year. Jason Bauer, Dunkin' Donuts. Jim Brennan, Myers Bank, a division of Mid-Penn Bank. Shannon Brennan, McCann School of Business and Technology. Denise Calderon, Schaefer's Harley-Davidson. John Crane from Crane Insurance Agency. Jessica Dean, Power Pump Benefits Consulting. John D'Angelo, Wegmans. Dr. Robert DeColi, School Health System. Maureen Donovan, Lehigh Carbon Community College. Elizabeth Hinkle, School Conservation District. Wayne Holden, Mrs. T's Pierogies, Atico Inc. Ed Catcher, Losh Realty. Edward Clea, from Representative Neil Goodman's office from the 123rd Legislative District. Jerry Labuti, the Greystone Restaurant. Kim Warmer, the Evans Network of Companies. Wayne Lutze, Tompkins Fisk Bank Insurance. Bridget Miller from Dave Miller & Sons, Inc. Patrick Moran from Schuylkill EMS. Jerry Neuswanger, Newhurst, Inc. Cindy Petrulis, Providence Place Senior Living. Tina Rose, Penn State Schuylkill. Mark Wiederhole from Google's Recycling, Inc. And last but not least, Tommy Shinsky, Arrow Consulting, Inc. Each year, a committee of past presidents and the executive director meet to choose a board member who they believe has the leadership skills needed to join the executive committee and one day become the next Schuylkill Chamber of Commerce president. I'm happy to announce the newest member of the executive committee, John Powers. All free time. We may have family, work, or school obligations that keep us very busy, but becoming an active volunteer with the Chamber of Commerce can be very rewarding. One of the many purposes of our Chamber of Commerce is to promote business recruitment, growth, and retention. Without this, many of us in the room today would not be able to live and work here in Schuylkill County. In addition, once educated, our youth will be unable to stay or return to our county to secure jobs and help our county prosper. A few minutes ago, you were introduced to 40 businessmen and women who believe in the value of the Chamber and have agreed to volunteer their time to further the mission of the Chamber. But the accountant in me, even without my handy-dandy calculator, tells me there are many more than 40 people who have joined us today and have the potential to become a productive volunteer. The Chamber has many committees, including the Government Affairs, Transportation, Member Services, Education, Nonprofit, Agribusiness, the Young Entrepreneurs Academy, and Schuylkill Women in Business. These committees cover a wide range of topics, and I believe everyone here could find a way to contribute to one of those. In closing, as the incoming president of the Chamber, I would like to challenge each of you to become one of those volunteers. The future of our county and our Chamber depends on it. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Chamber Annual Luncheon. When I served with Commissioner Stottmeyer, he used to say a couple things. One of them was, it's a great day in Schuylkill County. And it certainly is a wonderful day in Schuylkill County. You know, when we set goals and we work to achieve them, great things happen. I said a couple months ago, we wanted to get to 300 people at this luncheon today. And I'm very pleased to tell you that, in fact, we did that. And I thank each and every one of you individually and collectively for being here. One of the reasons that I know many of you are in the room is our keynote speaker today. You know, one of the things that we do in Schuylkill County, do it well and do it passionately, is rally around our own. We are Schuylkill County proud. And while the Schuylkill Chamber of Commerce represents much more than just Schuylkill County, we're regional, not county-based. Having been born and raised here in the county myself, I couldn't be prouder when I have an opportunity to introduce one of our own. Someone that not only began their career, but was passionate enough about it to go to the very top of her profession. Today it's the Schuylkill Chamber of Commerce and my great privilege to introduce Megan Brennan, our 74th Postmaster General of the United States and the Chief Executive Officer of the world's largest postal organization. As I sat there and I tried to come to grips with the incredible task of having 600,000 employees, I was absolutely mind-boggled. I've supervised a lot of people in my time, thousands of them, but 600,000 is quite frankly beyond my comprehension. She, of course, was appointed the Postmaster General in February of this year after serving 4 years as the Chief Operating Officer and more than two decades in other leadership roles in the Postal Service. She has a impressive 29-year Postal Service career, beginning at the very basic letter carrier in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. What better way to learn your job than, as we've all heard many times, begin at the grassroots? She completed her undergraduate degree in Pennsylvania at Immaculata College, and she earned her Master's of Business Administration degree as a Sloan Fellow at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Throughout her career, she clearly has worked with many Postal Service customers and employee groups collaboratively. We had that discussion here as she flies all over the country to basically talk to her network of service groups. As the Postmaster General, her core focus is to invest in the future, improve the customer experience, and shape the growth opportunities for the organization and the industry it serves. Clearly, no matter what business, the basic business agenda. I have to tell you that as we were able to secure her to come here today, we did not take that for granted. Yes, we know she's Schuylkill County born and raised, and we're so proud about that, but we also understand that she's into a very large job at the highest level of play. And then came the infamous trip of our friend from Gettysburg down into Washington to deliver the mail. And I thought to myself, I hope this is not part of Megan's plan of innovation. It's a joke. But seriously, I couldn't help but think the world we live in, how crazy it is, and how we work every day to do the right things, and then things like that happen out of nowhere. But I know one thing. Megan, as a leader of the U.S. Postal Service, will take the Postal Service to greater heights. She will certainly think outside the box. She will certainly be customer-oriented, and she will never forget where her grassroots of Schuylkill County have come from. And it is our great pleasure and honor to welcome you home, Megan Brennan, to the 300 people in this room that are so anxious to hear your words. Welcome home.
nicest introductions I've had in some time. I appreciate that. Thank you, everyone, for being here today and providing me the opportunity to speak with you. I was telling Bob my travels this week took me to Milwaukee, Memphis, and now Mountain Valley. And I can tell you, I'm very pleased to be at Mountain Valley. And had I known that madness on the mountain occurs, a few hours later I may have adjusted my schedule. And I was also thinking, when Tony mentioned about the goals of the chamber, recruitment, retention, and growth, very similar to the Postal Service. Because clearly, we continue to look for new revenue streams. I want to thank you all first for your business, as business leaders, as well as consumers. So what I'd like to do today is really just talk to you a little bit about the Postal Service, put in context the size and scale, which is actually core to who we are. Everyone is our customer. Everyone in America is our customer. The Postal Service mission, our role mandate, is unchanged 240 years later. It's to provide universal service to every American. And we take that role very seriously. Now, if the Postal Service were a private company with a $67 billion revenue base, we would be 43rd on the top 100 Fortune 100 companies in this country. So we manage big. I would like to take a moment. Bob mentioned about 600,000 employees, and it is the dedication of the men and women of the Postal Service that provide the service that you deserve and expect day in and day out across this country. We have a number of postal employees here, both active and retirees, and I'd like to take a moment to recognize them. If they would stand, please. They're also part of my security details. So I thank them for their service. And the Postal Service has an unrivaled network. We have 31,000 post office locations. We have another 60,000 partnerships with private industry where we sell our stamps and other products. We have 320 mail processing facilities. We have more than 210,000 vehicles that travel practically every road in this country 6 days a week, driving roughly 4 million miles. That's a lot of activity. That's all to bind the nation together. The Postal Service is part of a much larger ecosystem. We sit at the center of an $800 billion mailing industry, of which many of you are a part of that. The Postal Service matters to the American economy. The Postal Service helps drive commerce and e-commerce as we're in an increasingly digitized world. So the challenge for the Postal Service is, how do you keep hard copy communication relevant? And I think those of you in the room know that mail delivers a return on investment. Part of our challenge going forward is to ensure that we enhance the value of hard copy communication. How do we keep mail relevant in an increasingly digitized world? By ensuring that it's personalized, that it's creative, that it's relevant. We're working to give print a digital reflection. Many of you are in the mail. Many of you currently do that. You use QR codes. You use augmented reality. Because if you think about, for us as consumers and how busy we are and how tethered we are to these electronic devices, I saw a statistic this week that 85% of what are described as the digital natives, you've heard that term, largely the millennials, have smartphones. Adults, 65%, have smartphones. More and more commerce is being conducted on a mobile phone. Postal Service has gone mobile. Are you aware of that? We have a mobile app. Check out our mobile app. We obviously have a very popular website, USPS.com. You get 1 billion hits a year on that. So the Postal Service is changing and improving to better serve the American public. But we're bullish on mail. Last year we delivered 155 billion pieces of mail. We process and deliver 40% of the world's mail. Now we're challenged. What I'd call some headwinds. Back in 2006, we had delivered 213 billion pieces of mail. So since then, we've seen roughly a 27+% decline in overall volume. driven partly by the recession, but also by an increasing diversion to electronic means. And many of you in the room use omni-marketing channels. Excuse me. And that's good. But my pitch to you, and I mentioned to Bob, that we're going to bring some postal employees back to talk to you about how you can better leverage the mail to promote your business, to grow your business. But the headwinds we face is this continued decline in overall volume. We've seen a change in the mail mix. Single-piece first-class mail, most susceptible to electronic diversion. That would be bill presentment and bill payment. And I won't ask for a show of hands of how many of you pay your bills online because it might crush me. But I would say to you, keep that bill coming to you. We want to look at that bill, right? So bill presentment remains strong. The challenge for us is to slow the diversion. We won't stop it, but we can slow it. And it's by enhancing the value of mail. So not only the decline in the overall mail volume, the change in the mail mix. The opportunity for the Postal Service is certainly in package growth. Last year, we delivered 4 million packages. We compete and we partner with FedEx and UPS. Last year, we delivered over 470 million of their packages. Because the Postal Service is on the doorstep of 133 million addresses 6 days a week, physical addresses, businesses, and residents. And the country continues to grow. Last year, we added about 900,000 delivery points. So the challenge for us is overall mail volume declines, the infrastructure continues to grow. We're delivering less mail to more addresses. Less mail to more addresses. And the change in the mail mix creates pressure on us because the contribution per piece has declined. Hence, some of our efforts to repurpose our infrastructure to support the growth engine, which is packages. But the other headwinds we face is we're an organization that is quasi-governmental. We have very limited pricing flexibility. Products that generate roughly 80% of our revenue are capped at the rate of inflation. Our competitive products, we have the opportunity to price based on what the market will demand. And then we have legacy costs. And this is not an indictment of our postal employees. I'm a postal employee. My 87-year-old father is here today. He's a retired postal employee. He still pays his bills in the mail. But we start out our fiscal year with $2.1 billion in upward cost pressure. That's general increases, that's COLA increases, and it's other inflationary pressures. Back in 2006, Congress passed a law that requires the Postal Service to pre-fund retiree health benefits to the tune of $5.6 billion a year. No other federal agency, no private business, has such a requirement. It is an onerous burden. So when you see the headlines in a newspaper that says Postal Service loses X billions of dollars, it's driven largely by our inability to make that pre-funding payment. Now, let me say this. It is the right thing to do to ensure that pensions are funded. And the Postal Service has paid into our pension fund more than $46 billion. But the challenge would be similar to if you were required to pay your mortgage in a 10-year period on this accelerated payment schedule. We can't afford to do it in an environment where the overall mail base is declining. So the Postal Service proposed that we establish our own health care plan wrapped within the Federal Employee Health Benefit Program, enable our retirees who are 65 or older to be fully integrated with Medicare. Because we paid $27 billion into the Medicare fund. So our retirees, 65 and older, should benefit from it. So that's the inside the beltway discussion that we've been having with our policymakers. If we were able to do that, we would eliminate that pre-funding requirement. And that would give the Postal Service some runway as we change and adapt in a 21st century marketplace. So that's some of the pressure that we have on us. Now, we're not going to cost cut our way to prosperity, we know that. But we've done a good job in controlling costs Over the past 8-9 years or so, we've reduced over $16 billion in the annualized spend. Year over year, showing gains in productivity. Now, we've got to grow. So in addition to keeping you in the mail and demonstrating how we can enhance the value of direct mail, keeping that personal, relevant, as well as creative, so that you get eyes on that mail piece. We're also looking at how we can become the shipper of choice for you, whether you're a shipper or you as a consumer. Not the low-cost option, the shipper of choice. And I would submit, if you look at our competitive pricing, if you look at our products and features, the ease of use, our ability to come to your business or your home to pick up, your ability to online utilize what we call click and ship, convenient from your home, to print a label, and also order a pickup. That's the type of customer value that we believe we provide. So we want to become your shipper of choice because we know there's tremendous opportunity in the shipping arena. In addition, we're looking at how do we invest to keep the Postal Service competitive, because we compete in every product line. And it's difficult to compete with free when you're talking about some of the online options. So we are investing in the mail, we're investing in our infrastructure. You've probably seen in the paper what tends to get the most press is when you have a vehicle fleet of more than 200,000, people are interested when you say that you're going to put out a request for proposal for 180,000 vehicles. So we currently have 15 suppliers that are qualified who will be vetted through our process, and we're looking at replacing our vehicles over the next 5 years or so. Now we're looking at better fuel efficiency, we're looking at the ergonomic features, we're looking at the size of the vehicle, because when the mail mix changes, you have more packages, you have larger packages, the cube capacity matters. But we're also investing internally in our processing facility. We're changing out roughly 30% of the letter sorting equipment we have, because the single piece letter volume has declined nearly 50% in the past decade. You can't have an infrastructure to support letters when the growth product is packages. So we're also looking to invest in some additional package sortation equipment to improve our capacity. This past holiday period, the Christmas period, what we refer to as our peak period, we saw an 18% growth in package volume. That's encouraging. But you can't build an infrastructure for that 3-week spike in volume. We've got to get more business. You probably read about a partnership we have with Amazon. We're delivering Amazon product on Sundays. So we established what we call customized delivery solutions. Sunday delivery, same day delivery in some major metropolitan areas throughout this country, and next day service. And this is leveraging what we call our last mile advantage. If we have 30,000 post offices, we're as close to the consumer as anyone can be. So we're leveraging that for growth. We're also testing other products. Now we have a Postal Regulatory Commission, though, that dictates what constitutes a product. But we're testing the boundaries there. We're delivering fresh fish from the Fulton Market in Greater New York. We're delivering cases of water. We're delivering groceries in Southern California. We're a delivery company. That's our core competency. So this is an opportunity for us to really look at how do you identify other revenue streams. They need to be profitable revenue streams because we have a mandate to break even. And we do not take taxpayer support. So when you see headlines that say the Postal Service is a burden on you, the taxpayer, we are not. It's the sale of our products and services that generate the monies that we can reinvest into our business. But know this, that the Postal Service, while we're challenged, there is tremendous upside for us to leverage this infrastructure for growth. We're also in our infancy of looking at digital solutions in terms of how do you leverage this same infrastructure that the 133 million delivery points, 30,000 access points. Think about TSA pre-screening. Anyone flying here? Anyone go through the TSA pre-screening process? What if you could do that in a post office, or what if you could do that on your doorstep? When you think about what's happening in today's environment, identity authentication, or in-person proofing. The Postal Service has the capability to do that on your doorstep. It's something that we're trying to flush out in the coming months and years. We have new mobile delivery devices. We'll have 225,000 such units deployed by this fall. Now, it's affectionately just called a scanning device, because as consumers, we all know you want to know where your package is from the time it was inducted into our system until it was delivered. And we've significantly improved visibility. But it goes beyond that. These mobile delivery devices have the capability of, one, us being able to track where that package is real time. So think of it from the standpoint of a shipper. If you're, I'll use L.L. Bean just as an example. If you're sending Michelle Bourne a catalog, God bless you. Michelle Bourne gets her catalog. L.L. Bean knows when that catalog is in her mailbox. They can pin her either with an email or a text message and provide an opportunity for her for 25% off if she goes online and shops within the next 24 hours. So we think there's real customer and business value in having that predictive delivery knowledge. Anybody ever wait for the cable company? They give you a 4-hour block of time, or now I think it's a 2-hour block of time. Well, what if the Postal Service could give you predictive delivery times within an hour? Is there value if you're the sender of either that package, that catalog, or that first class letter? That's something that we're trying to flush out and getting some feedback from the industry. A large part of my job is speaking with members of the industry to see what the Postal Service can do to better serve them. And it goes beyond what I'm learning, transit time performance. It is about visibility. It's always about the price point. I recognize that. One thing I would ask you to consider as a business leader, if you're not in the mail, consider getting into the mail. Consider direct mail. If you're a small business owner, consider a product we have called Every Door Direct Mail, or EDDM. This is a service that enables you to either identify zip codes or a zip code or a neighborhood that you want to target. It's relatively inexpensive, and it works. And we have folks who can certainly show you how to do that, how to create that mail piece. But that's just one example of how we're trying to innovate in the mail. So from a Postal Service standpoint, we'll continue to change and improve. We know we have to compete for your business. I'd be more than happy to hear from you in terms of what we can do to support your business, what specifically we can do to help support growth with the Chamber. Because I would tell you that what we've seen in recent years is when we partner and collaborate with the industry, and the industry is the business leaders, there's enhanced value for both the Postal Service and for you. So with that, let me close. Let me thank you. And Bob, I'd be happy if there's time to take any questions, or I'll certainly be around to talk with you. But know this, we appreciate your support. You're all customers of the Postal Service. And I personally appreciate your support and thank you. And tell you that there's nothing better than coming home to Schuylkill County. And certainly, I appreciate all your support and the congratulatory messages that I've received. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Megan. We appreciate that so much. I mean, it's a very clear message. You're passionate. You're looking at everything very closely. You're committed to the good things that are happening, plus to find the ways to change for the positive. And we, as the Chamber of Commerce, want to partner with you in the Postal Service to educate our business members and nonprofit members of how we can do things better with you. It's all about doing things in productive ways, innovative ways, and certainly our member base needs to hear how you can help us, and we're here to help you deliver that message. So thank you so much for being here. One of the obvious things that we would do at this time, and I just want to make sure you know why we're not doing it, is to present our keynote speaker with a gift. But in the world we live in today, she has very strict ethic requirements and things that she can just not do. So, Megan, as I said to you before, our gift to you is 300 friends and family in this room that all love Megan Brennan and are ecstatic to have you home.
Thank you.
and I can't help but saying this before I turn it back over to Karen, I would entitle this annual luncheon, "I Am Woman, Hear Me Roar." If there was any doubt in your mind, gentlemen, that we're in charge, just get that right out of your mind. We are not in charge, we have never been in charge, we will not be in charge again. Before I turn it back over to Karen, that seriously, we've had a tremendous chamber year. Karen Kendra and I came into this office of presidency with great passion. She's lived every moment of every day with that same passion. You can hear it in her voice, you can see it in any event, and she's been at every one of them that we've hosted during the last 11 months. She has a month plus to go, a little more, 2 months almost to go. And she'll finish the year with excellence. But her north, south, east, west, and the commitment to make sure that this Chamber of Commerce grows and is in every aspect of our region, not just our county, is a hallmark of Karen's presidency. And she's led by example, and she's done it par excellence. Karen, on behalf of the Chamber, the staff, the Executive Committee, the Board of Directors, but most importantly, your entire business and nonprofit peer group, we can't thank you enough for your leadership, not just this year, but as I always say, over the 10 years that you've served as a leader on the Executive Committee. You've done it, and you've done it extremely well, and we'll be indebted for a long time to your leadership. Thank you, Karen. And of course, I have to welcome aboard soon, on July 1, my new incoming president, Toni Everbitdale. Again, worked with Toni for a long period of time already. She will make an excellent leader. She's very humble. You know, she'll sit there and tell me she doesn't like public speaking, and then she gets up here and knocks it out of the park. So, I mean, I'm very, very blessed. You know and you can see that our executive committee and our board of directors, I think, is the best, the brightest of anywhere, any place, any organization. This chamber is being led by the winners, and it's not an accident that the Schuylkill Chamber of Commerce is growing. It's because of our leaders, both on the Executive Committee, the Board of Directors, through our committee activity, and each and every one of you in the room. I could not personally be prouder, and Toni, I look so much forward to working with you. And I just have to say this, I mean, thank you, Toni, and thank you, Karen, for those beautiful awards. Certainly the staff wasn't expecting it, and I need to speak on behalf of the staff, I feel. I've been here 6 years now, and I can tell you I've never seen a more frantic period of time than the last 2 months. Just today, as we're preparing for an annual luncheon, we're pushing out our newsletter, and it went to the post office this morning. By the way, Megan, I do open my bills and I pay them. I don't like what I see in them from my family, but I do open them and I pay them through the U.S. Postal Service. But seriously, back to the staff, it's just an example that whether we were working on awards a couple weeks ago with Jim Morad for the election of our officers, our appointment of our new executive committee member, then right into the annual luncheon, the YAID program. I mean, it has just been totally unbelievable, and I'm going to tell you that I am so, so fortunate to have the three ladies that I work with every day, Monica Warburn, Vanessa Mahoda, Andrea Feathers, our intern from Penn State, and Carol Boyer coming on board with the YAID program. I am so blessed. I do not know another group of individuals that could have pulled this off the way they have. It has been the most efficient thing that I've ever seen, and quite frankly, I have really high standards and ain't blown me away. So, thank you so much.
We are growing.
And I'm sure, speaking of efficiency, Karen's going to mention this, but I just have to point out for several years now, we've been coming here to the annual luncheon, and as I turned to Megan and we were having our lunch, I said, you know, watch this. This is going to go so efficiently, you're not going to believe it. Because, again, Mountain Valley, always exceeds my expectations, and to put 300 meals out, not obtrusively, in that short a period of time. You guys are the best. You're to be applauded. The food was excellent. The rest was here is wonderful. Rizzo was running wires. I mean, it's just unreal what they'll do. Nothing too much to ask here in Mount Valley, and it comes off, you know, quality experience, and we're blessed to be able to come here and have this wonderful lunch. And thank you again, Junior. Thank you to the whole staff. We appreciate it so much. And now back to our president, Karen Canterbine. Thank you.
Just a few more items. We would like to thank our title sponsor, Cackle Federal Credit Union. Our Door to Award sponsor, Everdale Trucking. Our sponsor, PPL. And our arrangements were provided by Forget Me Not Florist and Sheila's Floral Gallery. Our golf sponsor today is Mountain Valley Golf Course. You can all golf after the event. See Rizzo wherever he is. Okay, and I also would like to thank you for putting on an incredible event. They always do here, like Bob said, but thank you for your hospitality and your excellent service. The table centerpieces will go to the person at each table with the program that has a red compass robe on the top left of the center page of the program.